Good evening, everybody, and welcome all of you to this live program at Orthopedic Principles. Today, our guest of honor is Dr. Michael Harris from Larissa, Greece. Dr. Harris is professor of orthopedic surgery at the University of Thessaly in Larissa, Greece. Dr. Harris completed his medical degree at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in 1990. He trained in orthopedic surgery at the Ioannina University Hospital, followed by fellowship training in sports medicine and knee arthroscopy at Heidelberg in Germany, and also an upper extremity fellowship with James Chow in the United States. Professor Handis is the founder of the Larissa Arthroscopy and Minimally Invasive Center and organizes seminars in arthroscopic surgery. Clinical practice and research of Professor Handis involves knee and shoulder surgery. He's been president of the Greek Arthroscopy Association and Sports Medicine and is an active member of the ESCA, where he has been treasurer, and he currently serves as the secretary general of ESCA. So today it's my great honor to introduce you to Professor Michael Handis from Larissa, Greece. Over to you, Professor.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Gopalan. It's really a big pleasure and a big honor for me to be with you. So my topic today would be management of knee dislocation from emergency department to final treatment. So I will try to cover this topic, which is a special topic, from the beginning of the injury and until the, latest treatment based on our current knowledge. So these are my disclosures, just scientific disclosures. I'm associate editor in the JBJS Connector Cases and editorial board member in American Journal of Sports Medicine, CESTA, and JISECOS journals. So as you know, knee dislocation is really a very rare injury. It accounts for just 0.02% of all orthopedic injuries. Probably some orthopedic surgeons will not see even a single case in their entire career. However, if you are in a referral center like our hospital, then you have to deal with this type of injury. A dislocated knee means most of the times a violent trauma. However, and sometimes, as we will see later, especially in obese patients, even a low velocity trauma can produce a knee dislocation. And of course, when you have a knee dislocation, for sure you have at least three of the four major knee ligaments disrupted. So the mechanism of injury is most of the times, as we said, a high energy injury like a road traffic accident, sports injuries, which is really a challenging, sports injury. And sometimes, especially in obese patients, you may have a knee dislocation, and we see that very common nowadays, even with ultra low velocity injury. Most of the times, males are involved in this kind of injury, and these are young patients. The mean age is around 28 years of age. So this, let's have a look in this video, in this gymnast, and we can have an idea of the injury of mechanism. As you can see, this is a very severe injury in both knees, and of course, as you realize, she dislocated both knees. Sometimes knee dislocation is part of a polytrauma patient, and unfortunately the risk of not to take care of the knee, but take care of abdominal or the head and other vital things. And we sometimes lose the diagnosis of a knee dislocation in these polytrauma patients. And sometimes these patients go to the IC unit, and this is not something that we recognized. And if in these cases, the results are really very, very poor. According to SEN classification, we have mainly five types: knee dislocation type 1, which includes one of the cruciates and one of the laterals; knee dislocation type 2, ACL and PCL; knee dislocation type 3, which could include both cruciates and MCL or LCL; knee dislocation type 4, where all ligaments are disrupted, and knee dislocation type 5, when there is a combined knee dislocation, the knee fracture, and these are really very, very challenging cases. Most of the times we have a posterior knee dislocation, but you can have an anterior, an anteromedial, anterolateral, or even you can have a knee subluxation. Be careful, because the first thing that you have to take care of it is the neurovascular structures, because as you know, popliteal injury is almost 20% in these injuries, and that's where you have to detect early if there is a popliteal injury, artery injury or not. Otherwise, if you don't recognize it very early, then the amputation rate is very high, more than 15%. The second important structure that could damage during this injury is the peroneal nerve, and one out of four patients may have a peroneal nerve injury, and most important, 50% of these patients will have a permanent peroneal nerve lesion because of peroneal nerve traction, and this is a big problem for these patients. So the first thing, let's start with the emergency department, that you have to do after x-rays is to make a reduction as soon as possible. And to do this, you need to put a slow and gradual longitudinal traction and to manipulate the proximal tibia. And most of the times, you will not have difficulties to achieve a reduction. And of course, you have to check your reduction again with x-rays. Then you have to evaluate your patient, especially regarding the circulation. You have to test the limb temperature, capillary refill, and if you are in doubt, then you have to do a Doppler examination in order to be sure about the circulation of the leg. And of course, the neurologic examination, you have to examine all nerves to see if there is a nervous lesion or not. What you have to take into account, be careful, number one, is that even normal pulses cannot exclude an arterial injury. And that's why you have to take into account some more objective measurements, like the ankle branchial index index, which has a sensitivity of 100%. And when this ankle branchial index is less than 0.9, then you have to call a vascular surgeon, and probably you need to do an angiogram in the leg. If it's more than 0.9, then you can be safe that the artery is okay, and you don't have to go for an angiogram. However, even in the beginning, in the first 24 hours, you can have a good circulation in the leg and with good pulses. An intimal tear can produce an occult injury and arterial occlusion even 4-5 days after the injury. That's why you have to monitor, have a close monitoring in these patients, especially during the first week. And this is a good example. This was a ballet dancer, a lady of 32 years old. She had this type of injury, as you can see, a knee dislocation. And 5 days after the injury, she developed this arterial occlusion. You can see the angiogram 5 days later. And fortunately, we realized that very early, and we went to the operation room to do a vascular repair. And in these cases, what you do is to make a bypass graft with an autologous vein from the contralateral saphenous most of the times. So this is really an emergency, and you have to recognize that. And if you do a vascular repair, you or most of the times the vascular surgeon, then you have to put an external fixator in order to stabilize the knee and give the best possibility to your anastomosis to be safe. So The indications in general for external fixator are the vascular injury, as we said, and sometimes we can put it in polytrauma patients in grossly unstable knees or irreducible dislocation, but we can discuss about that. If you don't have a vascular injury, then there are some other indications, acute surgical indications to interfere with this knee dislocation. And the first one is an irreducible dislocation. This is an example of a 22-year-old male with a femoral fracture, a knee dislocation with ACL, PCL, and MCL. And after we plating his femur, we did not want to put a nail because we did not want to put traction in the dislocated knee. This is very dangerous. That's why we played the nail, and then we went to examine the knee. And as you can see, there is a gross instability in the anteroposterior plane, and you can make a reproduction of dislocation and subluxation, mainly because of the gross disruption of the MCL. You will see in a minute how unstable is the knee in this position, how easily it dislocates. So you have to do something with this knee, and you cannot accept a malreduction of the knee like this one. So most of the times, this malreduction is due to collateral ligaments, and that's where you have to go back and repair the collateral ligaments. In this case, the MCL with two suture anchor for the deep MCL. And then, as you can see, the knee is well aligned and in good contour. Another acute surgical indication is the Dibble sign. This is actually a posterolateral dislocation, and this is because of button holing of the medial femoral condyne into the anteromedial knee capsule. This patient was referred to our department from another hospital. You can see very clearly the Dibble sign, and the surgeon just sutured his skin, which is really very, very dangerous. And he came to our department in this situation. This is an Dibble sign, means irreducible dislocation, and it requires open reduction. So this was his condition in the emergency department. You cannot leave this patient without any acute intervention. So we went to the operation room, we make a capsular release, reduction of the medial condyle, and suturing of the medial structures, the MCL and the posterior oblique. There are also some other acute absolute indications for acute surgical management, especially from the medial side. And these are the tibial-sided avulsion injuries. Well, the MCL is avulsed from the tibia, the so-called Stenner lesion, when the MCL is outside of his insertion, and finally, when the MCL is trapped into the joint. All these injuries are rare injuries. This is an example of a tibial-sided injury. You can see the MCL, which has been avulsed from the tibia, and in the MRI, you can see the wave sign, which is the waving of the superficial layer. And in these cases, the MCL has been avulsed from the tibial side. So in this case, you have to go and operate this patient, fix the MCL, because this is a golden opportunity to fix the MCL, repair the MCL without any grafts or other complicated procedures. This is another example, a very, very seldom injury, MCL trapped into the joint, 42-year-old and fall from a height. You can see very nicely in the MRI how the MCL is entrapped. It has been avulsed from the femoral part and entrapped into the joint. This is really very impressive MRI. And so we went acutely in the operation room, and we did an acute repair from the MCL. So you can see now how the MCL was entrapped into the joint, how we release it, put it in place, and fix it with two suture anchors in the femoral part for both the posterior oblique ligament and the superficial band of the MCL. So this is something that you have to do it acutely. Another indication for acute intervention is the fibular head avulsion fractures. Again, you have a very good opportunity to repair these structures and in otherwise, you have to do complicated procedure if you put in a later stage your operation. However, most of the times you don't have a vascular injury or you don't have any other acute surgical intervention. And then in these cases, you have just to put a knee brace or a splint and to make an MRI and to see where are the lesions in the dislocated knee. And then you have two options, either if you go to for an acute, let's say, reconstruction. Acute means between 3 and 4 weeks, or you can go for a chronic intervention. Personally, if there is no any specific indication, as we discussed before, for an acute intervention, I prefer a delayed reconstruction. And for this reason, I put a knee brace, starting cryotherapy, crutches, and the patient starts physiotherapy after 10 days, which includes strengthening exercises in order to achieve full knee extension, knee flexion of at least 120 degrees, because this is very, very important. Don't forget that the biggest predictor of postoperative range of motion is the preoperative range of motion. It's an almost impossible to get more range of motion after your surgery in comparison to what you said before surgery. So if you have a full knee extension and a good knee flexion, more than 120 degrees, then you can go for surgery. Of course, based on the MRI, you know what in your clinical examination, you know where are the lesions. Usually, as we said, it's the ACL, the PCL, and like in this case, the popliteus tendon and the lateral collateral ligament, which has been ruptured from the tibial side. So you have to prepare in a very systematic way for your surgery. You need good assistance. And of course, there is no doubt that surgical treatment offers superior results in terms of knee function, stability, quality of life, and sometimes return to sports for these patients. And this is something that we know many, many years ago. As we said, you need at least 3 to 4 weeks after the injury, even if you go for an acute reconstruction. And this is because you need to give time to the capsule to have a good healing. Otherwise, you will have a lot of trouble because the water escapes from the knee capsule and you may have a compartment syndrome and problems during the operation. This is another reason that I prefer to go for a delayed reconstruction. These are some examples. This is a patient with a knee dislocation, but it has a highly unstable knee, as you will see. The knee is dislocated even with little force. And of course, you have to do something in this knee. You cannot leave it like that. You have to go for an acute intervention. However, in this case, you can go with this ground instability, with a good range of motion, you can go for a delayed reconstruction. As for the surgical approach and surgical technique, you have to do all the ligament reconstruction or repair in one stage. And to do this, you have to start with arthroscopy to evaluate the knee joint. And at the same time, you have to take care also of meniscal and cartilage lesion. So you have to reconstruct, as we said, at one stage, all the ligaments, except if it's an acute If there is an acute intervention of the collateral, then you can do a staged procedure. Otherwise, if you go for a delayed reconstruction, you have to reconstruct or repair all ligaments, ACL, PCL, LCL, MCL in one operation. And of course, you have to take care for fluid extravasation and compartment syndrome, especially when you are dealing with the PCL tibial tunnel. And we're going to discuss a little bit more about that later on. As we said, you need a good assistant. You need access to allografts, because most of the time you need some allografts. I personally use Achilles tendon allograft for my PCL reconstruction, for my ACL hamstrings or patellar tendon bone autograft. For the MCL, depends on the time and the posterolateral collateral ligament, I combined repair and augmentation, or just augmentation if it's a chronic case. And for this, I'm using the hamstring autograft from the contralateral leg, which is a very, very nice graft. And if there are no more autografts available, then I'm using tibialis anterior or posterior tibialis allograft for my collateral ligament reconstruction. So the first thing is to start with an arthroscopic evaluation. This is a case of an ACL, PCL, and lateral structure tear. Here we're in the lateral compartment. This is almost 4 weeks, 5 weeks, if I remember well, after the operation. You can see the drive-through sign and the opening in the lateral compartment, the hematoma in the lateral structures. Meniscus seems okay, the cartilage seems okay, but you will see in a minute the popliteus tendon, the avulsion of the popliteus tendon from the femoral side. As I'm pulling this structure into the joint, you will see that it has been avulsed from the femoral part. And of course, you need not just to repair it, but you have to augment it as well. Here, you can see the avulsion of the tendon from the femoral part. It's a very, very nice picture, and you believe me, you don't have the possibility to see it very often. As for the intra-articular part, you have to start with the ACL femoral tunnel, PCL femoral tunnel, ACL tibial tunnel, and then as a final step, you have to do the PCL tibial tunnel, which is the most tricky part of the procedure, and the most dangerous, I would say. To do this, you need a posteromedial portal in the beginning, and for this, you have to go into the posterior compartment of the knee and make your posteromedial portal using a spinal needle and a knife, and then you can alternate the scope in the posteromedial portal, create the posterolateral portal, and do the transeptal approach, which has been popularized by Ahn from Korea, and it has been published in Arthroscopy 2003. And this is really a very, very nice procedure. You can see I have my scope in the posteromedial portal, and now I'm creating the posterolateral portal, and I debride the septum. My scope is in the posteromedial portal now, and my saver in the posterolateral, and you can have a very, very good and clear view of the PCL. This is the PCL remnants, and this is the guide of the PCL. Initially, I tend to use fluoroscopy, but now I almost never use fluoroscopy, because I think that this is a very accurate procedure, and you can see everything from the posteromedial and posterolateral portal. And the final step is to pass the graft. This is an Achilles tendon PCL allograft. And here we pull the graft from the femur into the tibia. As you see, it's a very thick and strong graft, because for the PCL, you have to put a thick and strong graft to withstand all forces. For the posterolateral corner reconstruction, as you know, historically, there are a lot of procedures like the glans biceps tenodesis, sling procedures like the Larson procedure. However, in our days, we don't use these procedures. In our days, we use most of the time the Laprat procedure or the Arciero procedure, which is my favorite procedure. This is a fibular-based procedure with one fibular tunnel and two femoral tunnels, mimic the lateral collateral ligament and the popliteus tendon. When you have a complicated and combined reconstruction like ACL, PCL, posterior lateral corner, you don't want to lose so much time with complicated procedures. The Laprat procedure is definitely more complicated than the Arciero. And clinically, there are no big differences based on biomechanical and clinical data. So that's why my preference is the posterior lateral corner reconstruction published by Robert Arciero some years ago. And these are some examples, putting your 2K wires in the femoral part. We have already passed the graft from the fibular tunnel, and this is an MRI, a post-op MRI with both screws in the femur, represent the popliteus and the lateral collateral ligament. As for the MCL, I prefer the Danish technique popularized by Martin Lid, which with this procedure, you have to leave attached the semitendinosus, create a femoral tunnel and fix it in the femur, and then you pass your graft your graft in the posteromedial tibia and fix it exiting in the postero in the I'm sorry, in the anterior part of the tibia with a screw, and this is the result of a patient with an ACL, MCL and PCL procedure at the end of the operation, so you can see not so big scars. This is the ligament reconstruction tensioning order. First, you have to fix your PCL in 70 to 90 degrees of flexion, taking care to correct the step off, the ACL in a slight flexion or in full extension, the lateral collateral ligament in 20 degrees of valgus, the popliteus reconstruction in 45 to 60 degrees of flexion and neutral rotation, and the MCL in extension and slight varus. These are our results that has been published in the New Journal, I think 2 years ago. This was a reconstruction with a delayed ligament approach. It includes with a long follow-up, minimum 5 years follow-up. We had 46 multi-ligament knee injuries. As you can see, most of them were male. The mean follow-up was close to 10 years, and the mean age was 28 years. And as you can see, the mean time from injury to surgery was almost 9 months. Don't forget that many of these patients are referred to our department not very early. So in most of the times, we are doing a delayed reconstruction. These are our patients according to SEN classification. Most of them were type 3 medial or lateral knee dislocation, type 3, and the mean follow-up was close to 9 to 10 years. As you can see, the average passive knee flexion and the active knee flexion were really very good. This was a very functional knee flexion. The IKDC, the CUS, the Larson scores were also satisfactory. And the average side-to-side difference was 2.6 millimeters. According to our analysis, we saw that the variables that had a statistically significant effect on each score were the age, the older the patient, the worse the result, the follow-up time, and What is also important is arthritis progressed in almost all these patients, and progress at least of one grade was evident in 77% of the patients, and most of these patients were able to return to work in 85%. However, what is really very important is that no patient required manipulation under anesthesia for adhesion lysis, which is really very, very important. And this is an example of an ACL, PCL, and posterolateral collateral, posterolateral complex reconstruction with 8 years follow-up. As you can see, the knee in terms of arthritis is really in good condition. Of course, sometimes you have really chronic cases, and in these chronic cases, you have to take into account the malalignment. If there is a malalignment of the leg, then you have to go for a high tibial osteotomy prior or at the time of reconstruction. This is very, very important. And in general, you have to remember that we are going for a ligament reconstruction when you have a varus alignment of less than 3 degrees, no lateral thrust, no arthritis, no subluxation. Otherwise, if you have chronic cases like in this case, posterolateral corner and PCL injury, 20 years follow-up, then you have to go for an osteotomy. And this is because sometimes the osteotomy, as we said, is the best ligament surgery for chronic PCL, ACL, and posterolateral insufficiency. This is a case presentation. This was a case of 39, if I remember well, years old male with a medial plateau fracture, with a fibular head fracture. So he had a PCL and posterolateral corner tear. However, he was referred to our department, if I remember well, 6-7 months after the injury. He developed already a varus knee, and this is his examination during after 9 months after the injury. You can see lateral instability, varus knee. So in this case, we did the high tibial osteotomy to correct the varus alignment with a slight hypercorrection. And at the same time, we did the posterolateral corner reconstruction. We did not perform a PCL reconstruction in order to avoid to do very complicated surgery. And the patient was really very, very satisfied. This was the pre-op, and this is the post-op figures, and he is really able to do all his work that he did before injury. So something very important that it's really a debatable issue in the literature is the timing of operative intervention. If you go for an acute or chronic ligament reconstruction, I'm not talking about cases that, like we said, with MCL trapped or Dibble sign, or cases that you have to do acute surgery. I'm talking about a knee dislocation without neurovascular injury, without special issues that required acute surgery. So in these cases, the literature is not so clear to advise for or against an acute or chronic reconstruction. This is because there is a lack of prospective randomized studies. There is a great variability among existing studies regarding surgical technique, rehabilitation, evaluation, etc. So let's have a look what the literature recommends. This is a systematic review which published in Arthroscopy 2009. And as you can see, the conclusion is that early operative treatment of the multi-ligament injured knee provides improved functional and clinical outcomes compared with delayed surgery. And this was based in the higher Lyme score, higher IKDC scores in acute reconstructed patients in comparison to chronic reconstructed patients. The same conclusion comes from this study, systematic review and meta-analysis 2017. And the conclusion, again, the results of this meta-analysis suggest that early surgical intervention in multi-ligament injuries of the knee produces a significantly superior clinical outcome compared to a late reconstruction. This is another systematic review. The conclusion here is that stage treatment yields the best clinical results for patients with knee dislocation type 3. Type 3 means that you have collateral ligament tear. However, there are no statistically significant differences between acute surgery and chronic surgery groups. So this conclusion is a little bit different from the conclusions from the two previous systematic reviews. And in this conclusion, which has been published in JBJS 2009, as you can see, the acute surgery is combined with, is associated with high range of motion deficits. And this is something very important because a big number of patients after acute surgery underwent manipulation under anesthesia or another surgery. And as you know, it's not an easy problem. This study from coming from the Orthopedic Journal of Sports Medicine also confirms that delayed surgery significantly decreased the risk of for arthrofibrosis, in contrast to acute surgery, where the risk of arthrofibrosis is really very, very high. So it seems that based on the literature, that early surgery probably, not for sure, probably provide improved outcomes regarding stability and function. However, there is an increased risk of arthrofibrosis. And as you know, or as you suspect, it is difficult for a patient to accept a stiff knee. It's more easy to accept a loose knee, but it's not easy for a patient to accept a stiff knee. And furthermore, it is more difficult for the surgeon to deal with a stiff knee in comparison to an unstable knee. So that's why when you have to treat a multi-ligament knee injury or a knee dislocation, and you have to decide if you go for acute or delayed surgery, you have to take into account the pros and cons. However, at least in my perspective, it is better to go for a delayed surgery 4, 6, 7 weeks after the injury. I'm waiting for the patient to have a good range of motion, and then I'm going for my reconstruction. And as I reported before, there was not even a single patient which required arthrolysis or manipulation under anesthesia in our series. So in conclusion, I would like to say that good or excellent knee stability is achieved in the vast majority of patients with delayed reconstruction. However, with acute reconstruction, you can have good knee stability and knee function. But at least with both techniques, the knee function is good for most patients. Return to work is highly possible for this type of patients. Return to sports is moderate. Some of these patients, I would say in our series, 65 to 70% were able to go back to not very strenuous activities or strenuous sports, but at least sports like jogging, tennis, golf, swimming, bicycle, and some of them playing basketball. It's possible in 70% of the cases. The younger the patient, the better result we expect. And unfortunately, arthritis development in more than 70% in the long-term follow-up is expected. And this is something that it has to do with the initial injury, the type of surgery, etc. But don't forget that even when you have an ACL tear, the rate of arthritis is really in the long-term follow-up very high. So the same goes for this multi-ligament knee injuries. I thank you for your attention. This is a view, an helicopter view of our hospital and medical school in Greece, Larissa. Larissa is based between Athens and Thessaloniki. And this will be my last slides. All of you are more than welcome in the next ESCA Congress, which will take place 27 to 29 of April in Paris, France. This will be a live event, no virtual event, no hybrid event. So if you want to attend ESCA Congress, you have to be in Paris, and we would like to see all of you in Paris. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor, for that brilliant lecture and very informative. Couple of questions from our side, Prof.
Yes.
If you have an MCL injury, for example, a medial collateral ligament injury, do you think there's a role for a repair, especially if it's from the tibial side?
Yeah, as I said before, when you have an avulsion of the tibial side, you have to go acutely for repair, because this is a gold opportunity to fix it and have a good result. So most of the times when I have an MCL avulsed from tibia, I'm do a staged procedure. I'm going for my MCL repair using most of the time suture anchors. Then I rehabilitate the patient to gain a good range of motion, and then I'm going back for my ACL and PCL reconstruction.
And also that would apply if there is a fibula head fracture, isn't it? When the LCL avulses with the fibula head.
Exactly. This is also a very good indication, and you have to do it acutely, especially when you have a fibula head fracture. Although this type of surgery, it's not so easy. I mean, you have to fix with transosseous sutures or even suture anchors. But again, you can stage your procedure, do the lateral collateral ligament, and then go back for the rest of the ligaments.
Thank you, Professor. And Prof, you mentioned about initial immobilization with a brace and as well as an external fixator. For example, if the patient is very obese, in an obese patient, how would you immobilize?
Yeah, this is a very tricky question, a very difficult question. Obese patients are always a big problem. External fixator is a good indication for obese patients. I agree, because you know, sometimes it's really very, very difficult to manage these patients. And definitely in obese patients, I'm immobilizing them with an external fixation for 4 or 5 weeks, then starting gradually physiotherapy to achieve an acceptable range of motion, and then go back for my final surgery.
Thank you, Prof. And also, Prof, suppose you have mentioned about when you have three ligaments, for example, you have ACL, you have PCL, and a PLC. What is your choice of treatment? Is it a staged protocol or a single stage procedure?
No. When I'm doing it in a delayed reconstruction, I'm doing everything in one stage. This usually takes, let's say, 2.5 hours, maximum 3 hours. But you have to be, you know, experienced surgeon. You have to rely on your assistants. But it should not take more than 2.5 hours or maximum 3 hours, because you don't want to make a lengthy operation for many, many reasons. But I'm doing the ACL and PCL femoral and tibial tunnels, pass my grafts, fix it in the femoral tunnels. Then I'm going for my collateral reconstruction, pass my grafts, and then I go back, fix my PCL first in the tibia, the ACL in the tibia, and then the lateral collateral ligament or popliteus as well.
Okay, and what about the tunica use? Do you use the tunica throughout the procedure, or you deflate when you go?
Usually I'm starting without the tunica, and based on the situation, sometimes I can inflate the tunica or not. If you have a lot of tunnels, then you may have some bleeding. And in this case, it's good to inflate the tourniquet in order to avoid bleeding. But you can start without the tourniquet to save some time, and then you can go back and inflate your tourniquet.
Prof, just one last question before we end the session. Do you think there is a risk of DVT, I mean, deep vein thrombosis, because this is a major surgery involving multiple ligaments, and do you keep them on the thromboprophylaxis?
Yes, of course, for
sure. All of them?
For sure. I mean, it's a big surgery. You work in the posterior part of the knee. Definitely, I'm using at least for 1 month thromboprophylaxis for all these patients.
So you put them on injectable for a week and then convert it to oral?
Yeah, it depends. You can go, this is a good option. I mean, to keep them while they're in the hospital for 3-4 days, 5 days in injection, and then you can go for oral, which is a modern therapy for this patient. You can do both.
Thank you, Professor. I think that's all the questions that we have for the session. Thank you for the fantastic lecture. And I'm sure this is going to benefit a lot of people all over the world. Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure. Thank you very much. And I hope to see you in Paris in a person meeting. Thank you very much.